it doesn't know what the one first one is.
We're going to go ahead and call a meeting to order. If everybody could please silence your cell phones. Thank you. And if you would please join us in the invocation followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
Thank you and good morning, everyone. I invite you to join with me if you're willing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessings that have come to St. Lucie County, and we gather here today to see how we can be a blessing to others. We ask for your guidance today, for wisdom and insight, for the strength of character, so that in all matters before this commission, we will conduct ourselves with honor and integrity. Amen.
Amen.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We're going to open the podium up to anybody that would like to come forward and say something under public comment. If you're here because of a public hearing, please hold that till we get to that item on the agenda. But if you have something you would like to address the board, please step forward at this time. Good morning.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, Administrators, ladies, gentlemen, good morning. My name is Robert McKean, Yard Manager at Director Fort Pierce, and I'm here to offer a brief update on works currently underway at the facility. First, Director has signed a contract with the county to fulfill the grant matching funds allocated to the property. This means that Director will pay the portion of the local funds required in approved grant processes that is undertaken by the county as the property owner. Thus far, we have agreed on some $600,000+ in local match, monies that would normally have been burdened on the taxpayer. Secondly, our contractor has started the demolition of the building fire sprinkler system with appropriate permissions and permits from St. Lucie County Fire Department and the City of Fort Pierce Building Department. The existing system is obsolete, borderline inoperable, and not near robust enough for any paint or welding work that we expect to undertake. The new system will be hydraulically calculated to high hazard level 2 with more heads and closer spacing than the current system. A temporary central fire alarm system has been installed for the duration of the renovation to the approval of Chief Langle and the SLCFD. The test pile program referenced at the beginning of the month by my colleague Justin Beard is still curing concrete. Without being too technical, these compression and tension tests are intended to validate our engineering assumptions and must wait the full 28 days curing process before it being put under load. That said, the steel jig used for the compression test has been assembled, and on the 21st of this month, a hydraulic cylinder and load cell will be installed to impart over 350 tons of force on the pile, twice its maximum designed load. After 24 hours, the jig will be moved over to pull on the tension pile at over 100 tons. Again, twice the force it's expected to see in the real world. Lastly, we've restarted our COVID-stalled conversation with Indian River State College about the apprenticeship program. The next steps involve a site visit to Atlantic Technical Institute in Broward County, a fairly new program that has been quite successful and one that we'd like to model here in St. Lucie County. We had a wonderful conversation with the staff at the college and had an opportunity to meet the new president, Dr. Timothy Moore, who was effusive about the IRSC director collaboration. To paraphrase one of his recent comments, the most dynamic spot on earth to be is where opportunity and preparation intersect. We'll be back in the next BOCC with more as the project continues. Thank you for your time and have a good day.
Thank you. Is there anybody else wishing to come forward? Good morning.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Steve Myers. I'm a business agent with Teamsters Local 769. I represent the bargaining unit here at St. Lucie County for the general employees. I want to speak on two items today. Both of them are on the consent agenda. The first one is item C6, which is the recommendation from staff to approve the collective bargaining agreement amendment. We met with the county, successfully negotiated, and I'm very pleased to announce to you that the bargaining unit has already ratified the agreement. So if you do the same today, then we will have a amendment to the collective bargaining agreement. We appreciate staff and working with them on the amendment for the agreement. The next item is item G4. It's a request from staff to privatize the golf course and maintenance at Fairwinds Golf Course. My request to you today is that you actually pull this from the consent agenda and let's vote on it as a single item. The issue that we have is, as of course representing the staff that works at the golf course, is their employment, their future employment, how it affects them. And right now, under this recommendation from staff, there are no guarantees for the employees. And the contractor that's Brightview, which will be the employer that is recommended to get the bid, is coming in with a lower number, obviously, than probably what the work is being performed now, because simple. They're only going to pay $11 or $12 an hour for most of their employees. You can find that on page number 90 of their proposal. It lists what positions they're going to hire. Full and part-time. Most of $11 or $12 an hour. That's how they're going to be able to come in and provide you with cost savings. Is that what we really want here at St. Lucie County? That we provide contractors that are only paying $11 or $12 an hour just so we can save $100,000 a year in potential savings? So, again, my request is that you would pull this item from the consent agenda and vote on it as a separate item. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Anybody else? Good morning.
I'm Robert Davidson. I live at 7302 Pacific Avenue. I have a letter here from the county attorney. Permission to advertise a request for an order to demolish an unsafe structure.
Sir. Can I ask you if you could please come back when we address that? That's going to be a regular agenda item. Is Catherine here yet? Should we go ahead and let him do it under public comment or have the what? Right. You want to come forward, please? This is on, it's on a regular agenda item, and it's just the assistant county attorney's coming forward.
So I should wait?
Ooh, hang on one second, please.
Yes. Madam Chair, it is a regular agenda item.
It's really up to the board how you want to handle this. You can wait till the regular item, if as you said, or we can hear it now, and still we'll still need to address it as a regular item.
Okay, I just didn't want him to be confused. This is, so just so you know, you can read your letter and your statement, but we will be discussing this as a single item on our agenda whenever we get to that item on our agenda. So I didn't want you to be confused if you were going to remain for the meeting. It is an item that we will be discussing to take a vote on if we're going to advertise it or not. So it's your decision if you want to read it into the record.
Well,
now.
Maybe I better read it just before okay. You take your vote. So, okay. You know, people forget things.
Okay, that's okay. Go ahead. Thank you,
okay.
Catherine.
Ma'am.
Sir, you can go ahead and read it if you want to now. That's what I'm saying. If you want to read it now, you can, but we will be addressing it at a later time. Okay, that's why I wanted you to understand where we were. So we'll have you come back up. Thank you. Is there anybody else? Seeing none, we'll close the public comment. We'll come back to the board. Is there approval for the minutes?
Madam Chair, move approval.
Sir, second.
Second.
So, Madam Secretary, it was Commissioner Hutchinson with Commissioner Bart second. Would you call the roll, please?
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
And Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. We'll move on to proclamations. The first one's Constitution Week.
Good morning. A resolution proclaiming September 17th through the 23rd, 2020 as Constitution Week in St. Lucie County, Florida. Whereas the Board of County Commissioners of St. Lucie County, Florida has made the following determinations. Constitution Week is the commemoration of America's most important document and is celebrated annually during the week of September 17th through the 23rd. September 16, 2020 is the actual 233rd anniversary of the signing of the Constitution of the United States of America. The Constitution ensures the rights of every American and provides the framework for the administration of our country, yet few know the date or celebrate its importance in any fashion. The United States Constitution stands as a testament to the tenacity of Americans throughout history to maintain their liberties, freedoms, and inalienable rights. The celebration of the Constitution was started by the Daughters of the American Revolution. In 1955, the Daughters of the American Revolution petitioned Congress to set aside September 17th through the 23rd annually to be dedicated for the observance of Constitution Week. The resolution was later adopted by the U.S. Congress and signed into public law on August 2, 1956 by President Dwight D. Eisenhower. Now, therefore, be it resolved, the Board of County Commissioners of St. Lucie County, Florida, that this board does hereby proclaim the week of September 17th through the 23rd, 2020, as Constitution Week in St. Lucie County, Florida. Passed and duly adopted this first day of September 2020.
Okay, for the record, I think it's adopted the 15th day. That's okay. Is there a motion to approve?
Move approval.
Is there a second?
Second.
Madam Secretary, call the roll, please.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. And we have with us some lovely ladies out there. Where are you?
There they are.
We have Miss Evans, Miss Harper. Okay. It's okay if you're here for this proclamation, step forward.
Here for another.
Oh, okay.
I'm Karen.
Well, please step forward. We're so glad you're here. If you go to the podium, just go to the podium.
I'm sorry. I forgot my hearing aids and I have no idea what's going on.
That's okay.
And you probably can't hear me either, but I see people are doing that. I just want to thank you for once again acknowledging this important date that if I weren't in the Daughters of the American Revolution, I probably wouldn't even know there was such a thing. But because I've been involved in this, I've become more and more aware of the importance. I've seen Chris at many of our celebrations back when we could do it down at the farmer's market. And after the last hurricane, we've just kind of with that idea. But I want to just reiterate that this is a big deal. The Constitution of the United States of America is the document upon which every democratic nation in the world has based its constitution. It didn't exist before our founding fathers wrote it, even though it was based on the Magna Carta, which was never written down at that time. I read a book last year called A Brilliant Solution, Inventing the American Constitution. It's in our county library by Carol Birkin. I mean, it read like a novel. It was so interesting. And if you don't believe in divine interference or governance, you will after you read this book. I mean, it was just meant to be. And the question is, can we keep it? That there's not a day that goes by that you don't read or hear on television something about, it's in the Constitution, but you know, how much do we really know about what's in our Constitution? But we thank you very much for this honor. And I'm sorry that I'm particularly deaf today.
That's okay. We're glad you're here. And we have a certificate if you'd like to come forward and receive it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now we have the businesswomen's. So if you'd like to read the proclamation.
A resolution recognizing the Port St. Lucie businesswomen's 4 decades of commitment to community action and service with their Ruby Jubilee 40th anniversary celebration in St. Lucie County, Florida. Whereas the Board of County Commissioners of St. Lucie County, Florida has made the following determinations. Since its inception in 1980, the Port St. Lucie businesswomen has operated as an independent organization separate from any national or international entity, free to set forth its own mission, goals, and agendas. The Port St. Lucie businesswomen, whose roots are deeply anchored within our community, has evolved from 21 charter members in 1980 to 70 members today. They are involved in a wide variety of fields, including auto mechanics, banking, education, entertainment, fashion, government, law, travel, and more. They have offered seminars and other community programs to address the concerns of businesswomen and offer learning opportunities for community members, as well as to provide career mentoring to young women. Their partnership with Indian River State College has benefited 68 local women through the award of $124,500 in scholarships to continue their education. The Port St. Lucie businesswomen recognize the importance of granting scholarships for continuing education to members to further their professional and career development. For 4 decades, the Port St. Lucie businesswomen have supported and served many community needs. They have made a positive impact on our community, from painting walls at the Pace Center for Girls in Safe Space, purchasing and filling backpacks with school supplies for Stuff the Bus, participating in Day of Caring food drives for Treasure Coast Food Bank, and Swinging Hammers for Habitat for Humanity. For 10 years, they have participated in and sponsored the Making Strides Against Breast Cancer Walk, raising more than $16,000 for the American Cancer Society to provide free rides to cancer patients, provide wigs free of charge to women, and to support the search for a cure, education, and outreach. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of County Commissioners of St. Lucie County, Florida, that this board does hereby recognize this Ruby Jubilee 40th anniversary of the Port St. Lucie businesswomen for their outstanding community service efforts to St. Lucie County. Passed and duly adopted this 15th day of September 2020.
Thank you. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Madam Secretary, did you get that? It's Commissioner Bartz and Commissioner Zadowski second. Mm-hmm. Please call the roll.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Would you ladies like to come forward and say a few words?
Yes, and Commissioners, my name is Donna DeMarchi, and on behalf of the women of the Port St. Lucie businesswomen, I want to thank you so very much for recognizing all that we've done for these past 40 years. I have my colleague here, Dorothy Cam, and while we haven't been able to celebrate much like we would like to this year, we do have our commemorative masks, so we do have that, and despite all that's happening, we were still able to give $7,500 in scholarships and $10,000 in community grants this year, and we're very, very proud of that. So again, we thank you for recognizing all that we've done, and we really appreciate your time here this morning.
Thank you. We appreciate you, because I know that you do a lot for the community. And we also have a certificate for you. Thank you, ladies. Thanks. Thank you. Now we're going to move on to presentations, and I believe Mr. Baper, he's here. We're going to do the NACO Award presentation.
With a mask.
Good morning, Madam Chair, Commission, Mr. Tipton, Mr. McIntyre, Doug Baber, Human Resources and Risk Management Director for the record. This morning I'm here with some great news. Your county staff has continued to excel in several different ways throughout the county. We have come up with some programs over the years that I would like to recognize that are mainly due to submissions from our media team, Eric Gill and his team. Over the years, they've submitted 24 awards since 2008. And I'd just like to say thank you very much to Mr. Gill for facilitating. I saw him here a minute ago. He's been facilitating those for several years and done a great job for us, and we appreciate it. So over 30 states and 542 entries went in to have NACO awards this year. This year, the St. Lucie County had the honor to receive five. We had five within three separate departments and included collaboration with two local agencies. So the first of which is, all right, just to go through the few, for St. Lucie County, we received one for the 911 internship program, the Direct Connect program through Mass Transit, the Fare Free program, also with Mass Transit and Community Services, the Florida Atelier Butterfly Conservation Extension program through Cooperative Extension, and then the Spark Mentoring program through Human Resources. So we're going to go through each one of these really quickly, I promise, and hit some highlights of each one and why they won. One of the good things about this award is the fact that it goes to the National Association of Counties, and it becomes a staple for a program that other communities or other agencies throughout the country can use as a program that they would like. So some of those have been duplicated over the years, and it's always nice to have somebody copy things that you've done and done well. The first one to go through today is our 911 internship program. So this is a collaboration between St. Lucie Public Schools, Public Safety Department, and Human Resources. The 911 internship program actually came to about at fruition when we saw a social media post from Fort Pierce Westwood Academy posting about their 911 program, and it was at the same time we were struggling to fill our 911 operators. So this program was very timely, and I just want to make sure I thank the school district for everything they do to help build our community and our employees. So with us today, I did see in the crowd Vice Chair of the school district, Catherine Hensley. Also, I'm going to have Dr. Helen Wild. She's the Chief Academic Officer. She'll come up in a few minutes for a picture. And Ms. Mildred Brown, thank you very much, Ms. Brown, and all the program things that you do for years. She's the teacher for the criminal justice program at Fort Pierce Westwood. Also, we have Alicia Seitz. She's a CTE director. Lanisha Robinson was instrumental in helping write this program. Thank you very much. She's one of the program specialists with the district. I'd like to thank Ron Parrish and his team, 911, Frank Amandro. Those guys actually help, they facilitate the programs, they get hands-on experience, they come out, they actually see what it is, you know, they're going to high school for, and they want to make a career out of, so they get a chance to see it before they actually do it. I appreciate that. In our staff in HR, we have Chanel Tomlin, our Assistant HR Risk Management Director, and our Talent Acquisition Coordinator, Sue McNichol, who helps push the kids along, and they do tours of the facility, and it's a really feel-good thing, and the kids actually, they really enjoy it. They get a chance to break from school, of course, and so we've had some really good successes over the year. This year, the program actually has 75 students enrolled in this program over the past 2 years. And one of the success stories is Alejandra Russellberg. She actually works in the Public Safety Department. She's a 911 dispatcher. She's actually instrumental during Dorian for us. She was doing our translation into Spanish. She happened to be on site, of course, there at the dispatching center. So it was kind of a dual purpose for her. And she's just great to see her come right out of high school, right into a full-time paying job with benefits with the county, and kind of keep her moving through the program. And we also help with college tuition reimbursement, so she's getting a part of that program through IRC. So it's a really feel-good thing. Corona, of course, kind of slowed us down this past year, but we're going to pick it right back up and hit the ground running. Some of the successes of the program that kind of jump-started in the criminal justice program, the teaching technical education programs. And this education is supposed to last for a lifetime, and it actually, like I said, helps them get hands-on experience. So if I could have the members that I called up earlier that are part of this this program, we'll get a quick picture with the board, and we'll go to the next one. That'd be Frank Amandro, Mr. Parrish, Chanel, Sue McNichol, Dr. Wild. Just guys, quickly come up here with your award. We'll do a quick picture.
If the board would come this way, please.
Right up in front of the dais there, please.
Good morning. Hi.
All
Thank you. Good job.
Thank you all very much. So the next award comes through our Community Services Division in our Community Services Department Transit Division. This year they won two awards, one for the Direct Connect program and the other one for the Fare Free program. It's Transit Division Director Mariah Dickel and her entire team actually helps put these programs on year after year. St. Lucie County Direct Connect program was instituted in 2017 and it has provided over 9,000 trips. This program was designed to fill the gaps in public administration for the service hours and several different types of residents that need transportation throughout the county who would not have it otherwise due to the hours. Our granting agencies continue to see the need and are providing funding assistance for this initiative. The second program that they won an award for is the Fare Free program. The Florida Department of Transportation awarded St. Lucie County a grant providing free bus fares for 2 years. Since implementation, the transit ridership has almost tripled. Going forward, this program has subsidized through the county and is currently under review for an even larger, longer extension. Mariah, if you and your team can come up front for a quick picture, please.
Everybody, come on. Thank you.
Our next award winner is the Cooperative Extension, Florida Atelia, the Butterfly Conservation Extension Program. With this morning, we have Extension Agent 4 for Natural Resources, Ken Jaoli. And he told me I was going to struggle with that. Sorry, Ken. The Florida Atelia butterfly is a rare butterfly. A rare butterfly that's thought to be near extinction. It has been rediscovered here in St. Lucie County as well. It currently thrives in the seasonal in Fort Pierce Inlet State Park, PSL Botanical Gardens, and Heathcote Botanical Gardens. The caterpillars can actually only live on a host plant that happens to be toxic, the kunti. The Extension Office has created an educational program to encourage the adoption of the Atelia-friendly landscape practices that has been adopted by organizations across the county. Because of this program, the Atelia populations were identified in 7 other local Florida counties. So thank you very much for everything you do, and congratulations on your award. Ken, are you here?
Good
there
morning.
You are, sir. And last but not least, our St. Lucie County Human Resources and Risk Management Department entered a SPARK mentoring program. With us today, we also have Chanel Tomlin and Leslie Jones, our Human Resources Manager, who works dedication to this program. The SPARK mentoring program started in 2017 with 3 classes totaling over 40 graduates participating in this program. Approximately 40% of the SPARK mentoring graduates have been promoted into higher paying jobs throughout the county. They have participated in 3 community service projects throughout the county and renovation projects for the following. In 2017, they worked with the ARC. In 2018, Frontline for the Kids. And in 2019, with the Boys and Girls Club with one of their team centers. I see the Will Armstead here in the crowd. So I want to say thank you to those, and I'd like to have those folks come up here, please, for the award.
Is there anybody out there that was in the SPARK that's in the room? They graduated through it?
Any SPARK graduates in the room? There we go. That's our new assistant director for mosquito control there. You want to come on up?
Come on up.
Come on up.
Thank you.
And lastly, thank you to everybody for allowing, for the County Commission, County Administration, for allowing us to continue these programs and continue to do things to better our community, to make St. Lucie County a best place to live and work. If I could have a round of applause for all the award winners today, that would be great.
Thank you. Next, we have the update with the CARES Fund. Is Mr. Jefferson? There he is. Good morning.
Morning. Morning. Good morning, Madam Chair. Board of County Commissioners, thank you for this opportunity to come before you to present to you an update on the CARES Act. First, before I begin, my name is Alfonso Jefferson, Deputy County Administrator, and obviously
Ron Parrish, Public Safety Director.
Without your support on this particular program, many of the successes that we've seen thus far could not be achieved. So we really thank you from the board for being so supportive of this particular program, and we want to take an opportunity just to give you an update on where we are thus far. Just for a quick agenda, we're going to do an overview, talk about the funding distribution categories, talk about some direct funding allocations. We have not mentioned that on some occasions, but we need to talk about that as well. Some challenges that we see with the CARES Act program and some next steps. First, let me start with the goals of the particular program. We wanted to make sure that we were following the CARES Act guidelines. That was first and foremost for us, because we entered into agreement with Florida Department of Emergency Management based off the Treasury Department. So we wanted to make sure that we were fully following those particular guidelines. Secondly, we wanted to make sure that our residents and our businesses in St. Lucie County were benefiting directly from these particular programs. Third, and as we have briefed you and discussed with you before, is we wanted to try to minimize the potential clawbacks that occur, because we all are aware where anytime that we deal with some type of FDEM or FEMA type program, there's always that risk of clawbacks. So we want to make sure that we were able to minimize as best as we can any clawbacks that occur. And obviously, we're always getting updates regarding federal and state guidance and evolving changes. We receive several frequently asked questions that come through that we are making sure that it applies to our particular program as well. So we're continuing on. That has been our goals for the program. Before I continue, I do want to take the opportunity to thank many, many, many organizations who have been involved with us in developing programs and implementing these programs. I'm not going to read them all, but they have been definitely instrumental in us moving this program forward. It was great to be able to partner with them, and we see a lot of successes from them, and they give us great feedback on how to improve the program as well. So it's great to be working with them. I also would like to say thank you to county staff. When you look at our individual assistance program, it's almost at community development, it's all hands on deck over there to move the individual assistance program forward. Pretty much in every corner of that particular building, you can see applications or documentation that is being processed by the team over there to ensure that a resident within St. Lucie County is benefiting from the program. So I definitely like to say thank you to county staff for all their hard work.
And you know, it grew so quickly that we actually had to take the Emergency Operations Center and move, I don't know, we have about 15 or so personnel out there doing intakes, and that's worked real well because we have the space to be able to socially distance, and they're doing a great job out there as well.
Absolutely. So a quick overview. I'm just basically gonna follow up on basically the funding that we received. It was $2 trillion came from the CARES Act. State of Florida allocated $8.3 billion. They distributed out to counties. St. Lucie County, we were awarded $55.5 million. Our initial allocation that we do have in the bank is $13.8 million. It's important to know this is a reimbursable program. And that's the key. We have to be able to show that expenditures have incurred in order to draw down the remaining $41 million that we have at this state. So we have to spend that 13.8, or we have to allocate that 13.8 in order to draw down the remaining $41 million. On July 7th, this is the program that you approve that we brought to the board. It shows you the various categories that we have from economic recovery, which is at 30%, social services at 30%, call it public safety, public health, constitutional officers at 20%, municipalities and unincorporated area at 10%, and we set aside 10% and for future COVID and hurricane preparedness items. It's important to note that you also provided the flexibility for us to move fundings based off the needs of the community to different categories. So we have been evaluating this, but this is the program that we have been following. Just a quick overview on the Board of County Commissioner expenses, and these are all the expenditures that we issue a check through. As of September 14, we had about $4.6 million. Now, let me stop right here. A lot of this is based off of timing. We see a lot of applications come in. We see a lot of payment requests. But what we see in Banner is a little bit behind what we actually see. So this is all information directly from our financial system. So we see on September 14 about $4.6 million. Through the CARES Act, we're about $3.2 million. Remaining expense about $1.4 million. This program is constantly are submitting payment requests to finance on pretty much on a daily basis in this particular program. Well, here's our funding commitments. As you're aware, we allocated $13.8 million for the initial 25% allocations, but we have total commitments about $18 million already today. So that means additional funds that we need from the state is about $4.2 million. You can see the various agreements that we have already executed that are in place and ready to go. And some of these entities have already submitted some particular reimbursements to you. We anticipate them to increase over the next couple of weeks. But we have a total commitment today of $18 million. But I can tell you after this meeting, it's gonna be higher than that. Because I got some new information this morning regarding our individual assistance component of it. Our individual assistance was at, last number I had was at $1.8 million that we have provided to residents in the community. Today, it's about $2.1 million. On a daily basis, we are issuing checks out there to the community. The funding requirements, and it's very, very clear for us and what the funding requirements is and what expenses need to occur, but there's three main items that need to really occur. As be necessary expenditures associated with COVID-19, they were not accounted for in the budget, most recently approved as of March 27th, and were incurred during the periods of March 1st, December 30th, 2020. Our timeline to spend all these dollars is December 30th, 2020. That is the challenge. I think we are up for that challenge. We're going to be pushing to spend as much as that $55 million as possible. I'm not going to read this extensive list, but this is the eligible expenses. Just to touch on some key items, we can submit for medical expenses, public health expenses, some payroll expenses. So it gives us some good latitude when it comes to it. Is it as far as reimbursement through the CARES Act? Some ineligible expenditures. I think it's important to communicate those as well. You know, we're looking at various projects, and we want to make sure that we stay within the guidelines. Can't replace any lost revenues. Can't address any tax obligations that are out there. Can't do capital improvements or those fixed capital improvements. You know, we have noticed that some counties have been looking at doing fiber optics, and we kind of explored that as well. But we got guidance. We cannot put fiber optics down as part of the CARES Act. So we can't do service packages, damages covered by insurance, can't do all those particular things under COVID. So we stay within these particular guidelines. To help us move this program along, we implemented some administrative oversight that are all eligible under the CARES Act. We have legal consulting services. We have auditing services. Like we brought on RSM, who has already started reviewing our processes, make sure our processes are in line. And they are going to be doing some spot checks on random sampling to make sure that we are meeting CARES Act guidelines. We had to enhance some components of our web-based software that we use Formstack. That's our system that we've been using. We have program management services in place, and we brought up a significant amount of temp staff to assist with this program as well. Ron, if you'd like to talk about the approval process.
Yeah, you know, initially we designed the system out of our FEMA of experiences and trying to design that process and make sure we covered all the bases. And, it, you know, it was a little bit of a challenge, so we had to make some adjustments there, and it's helped out quite a bit, especially in the small business community, so we could help them streamline their process. So currently, you know, the applications come in, and then they go through the liaison to a director under each of the five initiatives, and then once it goes through them, it goes to our coordinator, which is William Weinschenk, and he does a review of it, and then if it gets through that process, then it comes to me for final approval. Now, that's on the everything but social services, where it actually, there's a little intervention there where it goes directly to finance so we can get those checks out to those that are in need. Outside of that, it comes back again to me, and then we do a payment authorization form, and then it goes over to finance for the larger ticket items as well as some of the small business community application. So it's really worked its way through, and it's really a good process that's been very successful. We just need more applications.
Let me talk quickly about the funding distribution categories. Under social services, you can see we have various programs that are under social services. As I previously mentioned, today we have like $2.1 million that have already been paid or in the process of being paid to residents in the St. Lucie County. That's over 900 households, averaging about $2,200 per household. Very successful program on the lunch pad with the Children's Services Council. We averaging somewhere between 250 to 260 kids within this particular program. And this is where they are in like a, I call it a hub environment. Rather than being at home doing virtual learning, rather than being face-to-face in school, they have social distance areas where they can do virtual training, well, the virtual school right in that particular location. There's various locations throughout St. Lucie County. This is in partnership with the Children's Services Council. You can see that we have a homeless initiative in place. We've already started our United Way partnership for the nonprofits and places of worship. Our agreement is in place with the Treasure Coast Food Banks regarding the seniors and vulnerable populations. And we are been working with the 19th Judicial Circuit on the eviction diversion program. This is a new item because we recognize that there are still people that are getting evicted. And so we partner with them, and we are addressing some individuals that are to avoid them. But this particular program is a partnership not only with the 19th Circuit, it was the tenant and the landlord. So both the tenant and landlord has to agree before we move forward in addressing the eviction process. You can see the initial allocation. You can see where we are as committed as far as dollars at this point. And again, these numbers are changing daily. Economic recovery. This area here has been a slow process for us, but I am pleased to say that we have made some process improvement changes to it in order to speed up allocation of dollars to businesses. These are business grant programs that do not have to be paid back. I want to stress that it's all about the documentation. In some cases, the documentation was not fully there. It slowed up the process. We made some changes to the documentation. We actually did research with other particular counties to see exactly what type of documentation they were requiring. In some cases, counties are not requesting any documentation. But remember, our goal is to try to minimize the potential for any clawback. But we still require documentation, but we're making the business to attest to certain things that were slowing up the process. So now we believe that we'll be able to speed up delivering more money out there to the business community. I can tell you over the last week, we've already processed over $100,000 in grants. And that has shown that we're sped up the particular process. We are in communication with the businesses that are out there. Our goal has been to follow up with them. I can tell you I know John T. and his team has. We know that the EDC has followed up with businesses. In some cases, it does take us some time to review the applications because we have to make sure that whatever they're requesting, that they do have some documentation to support the amount. If they do not have that documentation, we reach out to them that make a request for that particular documentation. But I'm pretty confident that we're going to be speeding up the process when it comes to the businesses and getting more dollars out to the business community. From a public safety and health standpoint, this is really many of the areas where we are reimbursing ourselves from the county department for all the expenditures that we have incurred. We're also doing the constitutional officers, any public health initiatives that we have, migrant testing program. That's a new item that's coming up in partnership with the state of Florida and some other entities as well. And I want to stress on this particular one here, the commitment for that program is $1.2 million. For us to have the resources in order to support migrant testing. If you can
get some information. So about probably about a month ago, FDACS reached out to me in regards to trying to start a pilot program for the migratory testing. And so we put together a couple meetings, had some discussions in regards to that with IFAS and the ag community. And we're actually putting a pretty decent program together that will start in October when that migratory population comes in. And we're looking at possibly a couple sites, but the fairgrounds being one of them, and possibly taking the mobile unit out to some of the farms to get make that testing a little more efficient for that population. And we're looking at probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 1,000 tests being committed to for that population. And, you know, that's FDEM's involved with it, FDACS, and I'm sorry for the acronyms, but that's what they're going by. So anyhow, but it's a great program that we've taken the leadership role in being the pilot program for the state of Florida. There are a couple of counties that are also trying to get this underway, but it's a relatively new project. But we're engaged and involved, and we're going to make it happen.
Right. Also, I'd like to remind the board that as part of this particular distribution category, $2 million has been allocated directly for the sheriff's office as well. It's part of our budget discussion that we had with you. So $2 million of our CARES Act dollar has been allocated directly and committed to the sheriff's office. Municipalities in unincorporated area, this has been broken out by population. We have agreements all in place. We've started to see some expenditures come through from the cities. We've had conversations with the cities. And so we will be processing reimbursements to the cities for all their COVID-19 related expenditures. And most of it is going to be primarily PPE and salaries for people that are working on COVID-19 items. So this program area is moving forward as well. Obviously, we talked about the future. COVID-19 hurricane preparedness, we have money allocated for that. But as we look at our particular programs, we want to make sure that we allocate the money to the needs that are out there. Again, you provided that flexibility. So as we look at this category, we will start looking at where we can allocate it based off the amount of activity that is happening in a category. As I mentioned, individual financial assistance is really going through the roof. And so we may need to allocate some additional dollars to that particular category.
We have had a little bit of a challenge in regards to our special needs shelters because of the social distancing. That population, for instance, in the Finn Center has to decline. So we were able to work with the city of Port St. Lucie and get the community center. And so we will probably use a little bit of these dollars in order to make sure that we can partition and socially distance and try to improve the numbers for that special needs population, because it's a challenge right now, because they need now you know, 110 square feet where before we could use 40 to 60 square feet to put someone in. And so when you increase that footprint size, you reduce the population. So Port St. Lucie's been working with us and utilizing the community center, which is a big, big help for us.
I wanted to just briefly go to direct allocations. These are totally separate from the CARES Act program that we have an agreement in place with the Florida Department of Emergency Management. These are the direct allocations that have been received from St. Lucie County. So I just wanted to briefly touch on them because as you're going to see in one of the next steps, we want to do a community report as well, just to let the community know what we've been doing with CARES Act. But these dollars do fall under the CARES Act legislation that was approved by the federal government. And just very briefly, we've received $157,000 from the airport. And for these particular direct allocation, they don't have to be spent by December 30th. They have a different time frame on them. And in some cases, they have different requirements on them. So the airport, $150,000, they can supplement for revenue shortfall. Airfield safety issues, St. Lucie Transit, $7 million for that. Bus operation, as you're aware, we're actually using some of these dollars to buy some new buses as well. Fair Housing Finance Corporation, we received $311,000 from there. We're going to be using that for emergency home repairs for the unincorporated area. For that particular program, the City of Fort Pierce and the City of Port St. Lucie received dollars. So that's why we're concentrating on the unincorporated area with our dollars. And the Community Services Block Grant, $308,000. We can use these forms for rental, mortgage, utility, and financial assistance. That's going to be continue to be needed within our particular community. Again, these are totally separate from the FDM agreement that we signed. These are just a direct allocation that came directly to St. Lucie County from the federal government. Just want to talk about some challenges and next steps. Some challenges. I always say submission of appropriate necessary documentation. Funding requests must support expenditures. Must support expenditures. And that has been a challenge, just making sure that all the appropriate documentation is in place. You have something?
I did. I just, you know, the challenge that we were having with the state is the communications process. And there's been this weird silence that has been going on. And so it has finally opened up. Actually, yesterday evening at 5:30, we received correspondence in regards to our first quarterly report, which we had not gotten any information in regards to that, which there was some good news in regards to the definition of expenditure. So that's very positive, and we're going to continue to push forward in trying to open up those lines of communications and, you know, try to capture that other $41 million, which is important for the community.
And just go ahead and piggyback off the receipt of the remaining $41 million from the state. We want to make sure we get that $41 million so we can continue these programs or add some additional programs. Timing of expenditures incurred under the program. As I say, this is a reimbursable program, but we're trying to show the state that we've already committed these particular dollars, either through PO or through some particular agreements that we have already will be incurring these expenditures, and they have already been committed. And spending of the funds by December 30th. That is a challenge. We're pushing forward to achieve that date. Staff is focused on that date, and hopefully we get some good news that is pushed out. But right now, our target date is December 30th, 2020. Some quick next steps. Definitely, we need the insurance that remaining funds are available to the county. We want to continue programs. We do not want to dip into our cash in order to run the programs. We want the cash that has been promised to us from the state. Development of a community report on the use of the CARES Act funds. Many of you have request detailed information, and we are working on that detailed information. How many households, what city are they located in? All that particular information we are working on to develop some type of report that we can provide to you. Continue to review programs to benefit our community. We're constantly reviewing the programs to make sure that they are meeting the needs of the community and evaluating. As you may have known is that at one point in time we had to halt accepting the individual financial assistance application so that we can kind of catch up. I can tell you today we are not fully caught up. I know the team is working very, very hard, but at some point, if the date of December 30th does not change, we may have to look at having a firm stop date so that we can catch up on all applications. Ongoing audit functions will be occurring. That's what we want to focus on. We have our auditor on board to make sure that we're meeting the CARES Act guidelines. And we also want to discuss challenges with lobbying team on the CARES Act program guidelines. We believe that some of these items, we probably should have received a direct allocation to keep the programs going the way that we need to. If there's any changes to legislation, we want to see how it can benefit us more in this program. Allow us to look at things that can be long-term sustainable rather than short-term fixes. Some of the items that you have in place right now are just short-term. Now, depends on how long this pandemic goes. We could be back in the same situation in January or February time. So we need to figure out and continue to look at how these guidelines can be more long-term, more sustainable. That concludes the presentation. We're here for any questions that you have. I have staff available. If I can't answer any questions, we do have staff here who can definitely answer that question.
Does anybody have any comments or questions?
Madam Chair, I just have a couple, and if they can't get answered today, I totally understand. First off, I hope that you will come back to us on those two programs that you're just now starting, the eviction one. I know I've had several phone calls from both landlords and renters themselves trying to understand. So that would be helpful, I think, for all of us have been getting those phone calls, that we also are able to put the word out what's required and how our program works. And I know it's still early in the development stage. And then the second thing is, and although many of these programs are very, very good, I need to go back to the one slide you had earlier, and you don't need to put it up right now. As mentioned, we've been allocated, but we've only received 25% of that allocation. And so when you're referring to the December 30th deadline, is that on the whole 100% or is it on the 25?
It's on the whole entire 55 million, which includes the 13.8 million. All of it has to be spent by December 30th.
Okay, then that's give me a little comfort level here, because the one slide you have is kind of misleading if you're looking from the outside and don't know these details. And that's where our allocation is on a 25% of the 13 million. Total commitments is 18 million, which automatically jumps out that I'm running the deficit of over 5 million. So I would hope we would come back. So I, just for everybody's knowledge, the commitments, and that's a strong word that was being used, do not commit me unless I, me meaning the county, without us having the CARES funding, meaning I'm not going to go to general fund down the road. I just want all this clarified so people understand this is strictly if we get the remaining remaining funds, correct?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Until we get the particular fund, obviously we can't spend those particular funds. We are managing the money to make sure that we don't have to dip into our particular cash. And I agree with you, it is confusing. We'll make sure that we update that particular slide accordingly.
I mean, those of us that are working, we take it for granted because we know we're not doing it, but the public needs to understand we have not committed to funding it unless it's funded through the CARES. It's not going to come out of our general fund.
Absolutely. You're absolutely correct, Commissioner.
So are you, as you take applications and process this, you're making it known to them that the application's in and they're approved, but they're only approved if we get our funding? Because right now, you have approved more than what we actually have, which I have had some conversations in Tallahassee last night. But like Commissioner Hutchinson said, that's where I was, is, you know, you're approving people and they think they're going to get it, but you're making it clear to them that they're only getting it if we get our money, correct?
Correct. I gave you an example, an initial financial assistance program. We have the funds in place for the individual assistance. So that has been continuous. We've been in constant communication with staff regarding an event that we need to stop applications. Mm-hmm. The residents are aware
okay.
of that.
I mean, because I'm sure, just like you, I have been saying to them, this is not affecting our general fund or our budget. This is strictly a one-time funding money. And if we get it, then you've been pre-approved for it. You'll get it.
Absolutely.
So I just, the clarity needs to be out there. So thank you. Any other questions?
Madam Chair, just to add on to that, one of the challenges that staff faces is This takes a lot of energy and a lot of work to put this together and to get the momentum going, and to stop now because we haven't received the next allocation would not allow us to even come close to trying to get that $55 million spent. So we are, with caution and with advice, saying we're going to continue to push forward in good faith because we have this agreement with the state that says we will receive this as it is spent. And so we are moving forward in good faith with the governor's office. And anything changes to that, of course, we'll have to pull back. But it is, we can only spend what we receive. That is the absolute limit.
Thank you. Any other comments, Commissioner Zadowski? Anything, Commissioner Bartz? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we have Will and Melanie here from the Boys and Girls Club. Good morning.
Good morning, Madam Chair and County Commissioners. Before I turn the presentation over to Melanie, probably the best COO in the county. I'm going to stand by my words. I want to thank you all for being present during COVID-19. It's been a huge asset to us as the Boys and Girls Clubs, who serves over 15,000 kids annually, to be able to know that our St. Lucie County Board of County Commissioners are behind our youth and our residents in St. Lucie County. So thank you for that. I want to also make sure that I give out some thank yous to our county administrator, Howard Tipton, the deputy county administrator, Alfonso Jefferson, Doug Baber, and George Landry, for working behind the scenes with not just Boys and Girls Clubs, but other nonprofits during some very difficult times. And while we all as nonprofits don't get everything that we want, there are lots of great conversations going on to make sure that we're able to work close together. Melanie has some really cool things that she wanted to share because of your support and the support of our community. So I'll turn it over to Melanie.
So first, I want to start. Thank you so much for having me here, Melanie Wiles. I want to go back, rewind a couple months ago to March when everything started in around spring break. The Boys and Girls Club really reacted with a response, a recovery and resilience. And so I want to go back to what the initial response is and how you all really supported us to make this happen for the people of St. Lucie County. So first, we focused on food. We did partner with the food bank, but we also realized there was families that we already directly served that were in desperate need because whether school was out and their children were missing their meals there, they didn't have transportation to be able to get to the meals. So as a result, we were actually able to provide 275,000 meals once COVID started to families. Some of this happened on our Boys and Girls Club blue vans that you may have seen out and about. Those were an investment from special people in our community to take our kids on these wonderful experiences. And when this happened, we transitioned that to be able to deliver meals to people and eventually turning those into pop-up clubs. So we took the investment from everyone in the community, and we've really reacted to make sure that we transitioned it to the best need. The second piece was being able to conduct wellness checks. So our staff was continuously calling families, checking in on kids, making sure that we connected them with some of the resources that you were already putting into place. So whether it was food, whether there was mental health going on, things to connect them, reconnect them with schools. And then third on here, I have a picture of Commissioner Dazowski because he was instrumental, as well as Mr. Baber and Nicole, in being able to secure funding from the Mortgage Foundation. It was a $100,000 grant so that we could provide 24/7 care for our essential employees. At that point in time, our biggest focus was to be able to utilize our facilities, utilize our knowledge as the Boys and Girls Club and CDC guidelines to be able to have care so that our county could continue to operate and make sure that it was taking care of its residents. So we did a little bit of thinking outside the box. I have a picture here of Commissioner Townsend. Many of you, we really appreciate you stepping up and really being there either on site or virtually for our kids and our families. Each day we've hosted the virtual club, which was in addition, before school started, it was every day to keep kids engaged in activities that they needed, educational activities. And then once school started, we also had the virtual component during the summer as well, where families could sit down. Maybe mom and dad had to cook dinner and we wanted to have an activity during that time because everybody was in the house together. So we tried to have a little bit of those breaks provided for families. And of course we had the leadership in the county that did our club code every day. So we appreciated that. The pop-up club, I mentioned about our vans. So we actually outfitted our Boys and Girls Club vans with generators, with tents, tables, activities. We even had certified teachers on our vans that went out every day during the summer, and we visited 15 different locations within the community to provide programming for kids. These were kids that couldn't come to our brick and mortar clubs, but we knew there was pockets where there was a need, and so our staff would go out every single day, set up these experiences for them, help them with their summer packets. So I mentioned before that we served 275,000 meals. Many of those meals were provided at Operation Dinner Table. So Operation Dinner Table had two different large events in the community, and many of you were out there. So what that looked like, we as an organization were given funds from an anonymous donor to really be able to feed families. And so we had the money, but we thought to ourselves, how can we have the biggest impact? And so what we decided to do was partner with Children's Services Council and all of their youth serving organizations. So we brought on 15 other nonprofits and we said, how can you get these meals into your family's hands? And so we added components like masks, different things that they needed, books. And we hosted two different events. There was the original Operation Dinner Table, and then we had a picnic edition during the 4th of July. We had hundreds and hundreds of families that we distributed food in lines. And when I tell you it started at 8 or 9 and families were lined up at 5 o'clock in the morning to get these services, they were desperately needed. So we appreciate everybody coming out to help us at that time.
If I could just add to that, if you ever need hamburgers and hot dogs grilled, Commissioner Mitchell knows how to do it because he stood out there in the hot sun with me for hours upon hours getting those things cooked. So if you ever need them, I'm sure he'll help you.
We had many county employees come out and volunteer their time. We had over 200 volunteers between the two events to make those happen as well. Okay, so we get into recovery. So starting on May 11th, we opened the first summer camp on the Treasure Coast. We did our due diligence to make sure all of the safety procedures were in place, and we set up really unique relationships. So not only did we operate out of our normal Boys and Girls Club houses, we actually set up a special relationship with the City of Port St. Lucie to be able to host a camp at the Mid-Florida Event Center. That alone allowed us to serve over 250 kids socially distanced in separated rooms at small ratios. We were able to provide camp at only $25 a week for parents, and in many cases, that was even scholarshiped. So that was a wonderful collaboration between public and private funding that came together. When I say summer camp, it started in May, and it went all the way up till the day that school started. So we really operated the entire time that parents needed us. And the most rewarding piece of that is to Will and I really, besides our normal staff, but we visited camps every day, and to have parents walk up to you and say, here's my child, thank you so much, I got to go to work today and go cut hair and actually bring home an income for my family to be able to be supported this week. It was very touching to be able to see that those parents needed that service so they could go back to work, and we opened at just the right time for that.
I think the other thing, if I could just throw out there, is that we had 20 certified teachers throughout the entire summer from May until now. essentially. And it was a big deal for us as Boys and Girls Clubs. We wanted to make sure that there was not just summer learning loss, but the COVID loss of kids not being in school for 5 or 6 months. So we employed 20 teachers during that time.
And what was great is that all of our kids, so we had over 850 campers that were able to complete their STEAM packets from St. Lucie Public Schools over the summer. We also had credit retrieval for our teenagers. And those kids that were in summer school were also supported, whether they were with us over the weekdays. And we also opened on Saturdays for them to be able to have extra time to make that happen. A really neat piece I wanted to show on here is that we had a number of local businesses, schools, people from other communities that came in, especially to the Mid-Florida Event Center, and said, how are you operating right now? How are you serving families? How are you serving kids? Everyone was so nervous at that time to open again, and we felt really committed to show people that we can all be brave together, and we can do innovative things to be able to reopen our doors and make sure we're still supporting our kids in a safe environment. So we were really proud in St. Lucie County to be able to host that. So we want to talk a little bit about our teens. Our teens had a wonderful summer. We had partnerships with many entities to include St. Lucie County. The St. Lucie Works program was initially there to actually help employ 50 teenagers. As a whole, we were able to have 156 teens that participated in our workforce readiness program, all of which received some sort of internship or job. So these literally would have been teens that were just on the streets all summer. Instead, they were engaged during the week. They had their internships. On Fridays, we actually hosted a boot camp that was in partnership with the Economic Development Council with the City of Fort Pierce. And what we were able to do is provide not only training of the soft skills through our YES program, but we actually took the kids on virtual field trips. So local manufacturing, all those businesses that we would have normally been able to introduce the teenagers to, they came to us virtually, and all of our hundreds of kids were able to participate in that. So now we move to fall when we were reopening for schools. As it was mentioned earlier, we are one of the Learning Launchpad recipients. We actually have 6 sites throughout all of St. Lucie County so that we're providing as many opportunities for parents as we can. So we have breakfast and lunch served, and we have to give it to our staff. They've done an amazing job with the funding that you all have provided. We have all of our kids today, almost 200 of them are in our clubs as we speak, and they're sitting in their individualized workstations and really having the support of our professional staff as they participate in their programming with St. Lucie Public Schools. In addition to the daytime program, we have opened our 15 school-based clubs and our additional 6 neighborhood clubhouses. So we are fully operational at this time. If parents are in need, we have our before and after school available for them. In addition, we also have A+ attendance specialists in 14 schools. So what that looks like is normal situations. It would be children that have 5 or more unexcused absences, where our case managers contact the parents and figure out what the obstacle is as to why they're not able to participate in school. Our team has really gone above and beyond, and they're even supporting right now in the virtual world. You can imagine how many kids we're having to track down and make sure that they have what they need. We're really proud of them to be able to step up and partner with the school to make that happen. We've actually hosted 2 events since COVID, one of which was our Fishing for Futures tournament that was in Fort Pierce just a couple weeks ago. We were able to raise over $30,000 for our programming and have a beautiful day on our Fort Pierce waters at the Cine Marina. And of course, the Chili Cook-Off. So this year's Chili Cook-Off, we had to totally switch up and be really innovative about. So many of you in this room have been to that event. And it was an event that we said, okay, we could push it off, but it was so important at this time. When I go back and talk about what our summer campers, those 850 plus kids, we were able to keep that rate at $25 in scholarship parents because of this event. We wanted to make sure that we kept it going for our community. And so I'm proud to say that because of the teams and the wonderful support from this community, we were able to raise over $100,000, which is for Boys and Girls Club having the event, our largest year ever. And not only that, but our county team led by George Landry was actually the top fundraiser raising nearly a quarter of that money with his team alone. So I want to give them a round of applause because they were amazing. They worked really hard. This event was 100% virtual, so there was nothing on site. We would love to be back at the Fence Center next year and have a blended event, but we really appreciate the community stepping up and virtually fundraising for us so that we could keep our services going. Just something exciting to come down the pike. So I mentioned earlier the St. Lucie Works program and how the county partnered with us to get our teens employed and get them off the streets. So it's very important for us as a Boys and Girls Club to maintain consistency for our kids, especially our teens. They look for us for the mentorship. They look for us to keep these essential programs for them going. And you know what? They really appreciated getting those paychecks. And so we've really challenged ourselves, and as you, I'm sure, know, have always keep putting the challenge out to the community to keep these important workforce readiness programs going. You may have already seen a proposal that we have go out there right now for our Learn and Earn food truck. I have my Learn and Earn food truck shirt on today. We're very proud of this program because it's a program where our kids can participate on a food truck. They can not only learn the background of culinary, hospitality, they're also going to learn the soft skills, learn entrepreneurship, and get some mentorship at the same time. And at the same time, they're going to earn a paycheck. They're also going to be giving back to the community because the food truck will be visiting food insecure areas, and our kids will start to learn there's other people in need in this community. We're very proud to say that the Bush Family Foundation has actually stepped up, and they gave us a $30,000 lead gift to get this project off the ground. We have some additional matches coming up as well. So I know Will may want to throw a little bit in about the food truck, but it's an exciting initiative that you will see hopefully coming down the road or parked here in the parking lot that will be serving food soon.
Well, if I could just add real briefly, you know, when we were growing up, at least when I was growing up, it was a, you know, you just earned money in the summer for the most part, and then during the year there was really nothing going on for you. This opportunity will give kids and our teens an opportunity to learn and earn throughout the entire year. We do a lot of talking at our teens, and now it's time to put some action to it and put some money in their pockets. When we put money in their pockets, it keeps them out of trouble. And so we're super excited about this. We're gonna raise up some marketers and some finance people and some customer service folks, and we're very excited about that.
Well, thank you so much for allowing us to share what this partnership has meant to Boys and Girls Club for the last couple of months, what it's meant to the entire community, and we want to keep it going.
Thank you both for being here. And I know that the Chili Cook-Off, y'all really did think outside the box. And I was glad to see that it was a success because that is one of my favorite events. Commissioner Zadowski's been involved in that. We were both an exchange club, and so we know the value that that brings. And your leadership and your partnership together has really taken this vision far beyond, I think, what anybody's ever imagined. And the food truck's another example of that. So thank you both for what you do.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, all this good stuff this morning. Now we have to move on to business. Before we do, I'm going to open it up. Is there anything the board would like to comment or anything, any of the presentations or anything? If not, we're going to move to consent agenda. Is there anything somebody would like pulled to discuss or separate vote or anything? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, I would like to suggest that the board consider moving community services consent item 8D1 and 8D2 to be considered right after their public hearing, which is 9B1. So 8D1 and 8D2 would be considered right after 9B1. And they're technically, it's more appropriate to consider them after the public hearing.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I'd like to pull 8G4 for separate vote and discussion.
Okay, so 8G4, that's the golf course. For a separate vote. And Mr. Tipton, would you please restate what you wanted or were suggesting?
Yes, ma'am. Consent item under Community Services 8D1 and 8D2 would be considered right after public hearing 9B1.
So are you wanting the consent agenda items pulled?
Pulled and then considered after the public hearing 9B1. Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
So 8D1, the block grant?
Yes, ma'am.
And 8D2,
yes,
the CDBG?
Okay, so. Madam Chair, I'll just add to it. On 8I1, which is the public utilities, and this is on the, I don't need it pulled, just for the record though, I am going to ask for support. This is on the Taylor Dairy Road plant proposal that, if you look at the contract of services, if you will, there's no date certain when this is to come back to us, other than a 300-day with additional. So I'm asking that the board be given an update at the informal within a 6 months time frame before they actually start permitting after that point, because that's part of what the timing is, so that the board is very much aware, as is the public, where we are.
Okay.
Good idea.
That's it. Yeah. Anything else? Okay, so is there a motion to approve with the changes for the under public utilities, changes per Commissioner Hutchinson, and excluding 8D1, D2, and 8G4.
I move, Madam Chair.
Second.
Okay, so Madam Secretary, there's Commissioner Zadowski with Commissioner Hutchinson. Would you call the roll, please?
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Okay, Commissioner Zadowski, do you want to do 8G4?
Sure. I'm kind of at a loss today. Heard from the bargaining unit for the folks at the golf course. I was under the impression that interest-based bargaining, the process has been collegial at worst and cooperative at best, and that all the issues had been resolved there. So I'm not going to support this today, and I'd rather you take it back and find the cooperation that we have always had with our bargaining unit and our employees. I'm surprised by this result today. I'm taken back, to be honest with you. I'm not going to belabor it, no pun intended, but at the end of the day, we've always worked with our employees, even in the toughest times after the recession and our most recent contract. So I'm going to suggest that staff take this back and find a positive solution, or if you want to vote it today, I'm not going to support it.
Is there any other comments or questions?
Madam Chair, I also will not be supporting this as it stands. I have concerns about the staffing, having been through this once before in my prior history. So if we can come to an agreement, I will relook at this, but at this point, I will not be supporting.
So do we want, Mr. McIntyre?
Yeah,
do we want
Madam Chair, I would suggest, based on those comments, that we pull this item and bring it back either on October 6th or October 20th.
Okay.
For report to the board, and of course we'll keep the board apprised in the interim of any issues that develop.
Okay, thank you.
I think staff will be pulling this item.
Madam Chair, this is not just a plain devil's advocate, no, because I'm in support of pulling until I thought we were there, you know, from talking to staff. But I just want to make sure that since this is an RFP, does that put us in any violations on? Do we have the ability to do this with no legal recourse? That's what I'm saying.
Sure. I think with an RFP, it's always an option that we could not go ahead with it.
Okay.
We can certainly continue it. We'll need to discuss that as well with the potential vendor. We need to let them know, of course, But our plan is to, I guess, re-engage and see if we can resolve any outstanding issues and then bring that back to the board.
Thank you.
Okay, and Mr. McIntyre, do we need a motion to go ahead and pull this, or we're just in agreement?
No, ma'am. Staff is pulling this item.
All right, thank you. So that item has been pulled. So now the D1 and D2 we'll come back to after we have the public hearing on the other item. Does that catch us up, Mr. McIntyre, on consent agendas?
Yes, ma'am. I believe we're ready to go to the public
hearing. Just want to confirm. Okay. We'll wait a few seconds and let staff exit. We'll move on to the public hearing. And what I'm going to do here is I am going to switch this around real quick. I apologize, but I do want to recognize that Judge Angelos is in the room, and I know that she's busy. So I want to go ahead and do the item number 2 first, if we could, please, so that we can get her out of here, and then we'll come back to staff with the chicken ordinance.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This item is a proposed ordinance, number 20-16. Relates to the Chuck Seafood and also the fire station property, which was once owned by the county. We're proposing today that the board consider granting a right of first refusal to the existing tenant out there. As the board is aware, the county owns that property where Chuck Seafood is located. We currently lease that property to Chuck Seafood to a tenant who operates the restaurant there. It's been operated as a restaurant for well over 20 years. We've discussed the possibility of selling the property, but the board hasn't made any decisions yet. We are in the process of exploring additional appraisal information so the board can make an intelligent decision on that. Regardless of how we end up deciding that, it seems appropriate to recognize that the current tenant has expanded substantial sums to renovate the restaurant, and it seems also appropriate in that regard to grant a right of first refusal in the event the board determines to sell the property. As I indicated, the board has not made a decision on that at this point. We also need to consider the adjacent fire station property. It's currently being used, I believe, a portion of it for restaurant parking. Just in way of background, the county donated that property to the fire district in 1965. The deed conveying the property to the district at that time contains a reverter clause that would require the reconveyance of the property to the county in the event of non-use by the fire district. Under Florida law, we have the ability to adopt our own regulations, and we're suggesting in this case to sell property that it would be appropriate to do that in this case for this particular property. There is a draft ordinance that the board granted permission to advertise. Staff recommends approval.
Okay, thank you. Is there any questions before I open it up to the public? This is a public hearing. We'll open up to the public. Is there anybody wishing to come forward and speak? Seeing none, we'll close and come back to the board.
Madam Chair, move approval.
Second.
Okay, so Madam Secretary, that was Commissioner Zadowski. Commissioner Bartz seconded. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Okay, now we'll go to item A1.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Assistant County Attorney Catherine Barbieri will be handling this item relating to backyard chickens.
Good morning.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Commissioners, for the record, Assistant County Attorney Catherine Barbieri and Monica Graziani, Code and Compliance Manager. And what you have before you is the second of two public hearings relating to backyard chickens. Currently in St. Lucie County, the only animals allowed in residential districts are generally recognized as household pets, which are dogs, cats, and caged birds. This ordinance would allow backyard chickens in five residential zones, RE1, RE2, RS2, RS3, and RS4 zones, excluding the River Park Overlay Zone. There would have to be an occupied, detached, single-family resident on the parcel of land. It would not allow more than 5 chickens, no roosters. It would be a maximum coop size of 125 square feet. There are setbacks in the ordinance. The coop would have to be in the rear of the property. There's a maximum height for the coop. The chickens feed has to be kept in a metal container. There is no free-ranging chickens allowed. If they're, for some reason, they're outside of their coop or enclosure, they have to be monitored, and it has to be by a person there. It cannot be electronic monitoring. They're not allowed to run large at all. Previously, the board has, as I said, this is the second of two public hearings. It was published in the paper on September 4th, 2020. There's also, I apologize, a registration requirement still in there, where they, for $25, they do register with our code and compliance division so that we know where the backyard chickens are. And staff is recommending approval. We are here for any questions.
Okay, thank you. Is there questions or comments? I have a comment. I'm not in favor of the $25. I mean, I just think that's a little crazy.
Madam Chair, would you be in favor of at least having them register? And let me follow along with that. That's kind of where I'm coming from. If, at least if they're registered, there's an opportunity to give the code requirements out to them so they know firsthand the setbacks that needed the height, so there's nobody surprised by that. You know, the requirements.
No, I agree.
I'm like you. I don't think the fee's necessary. I just look at it as an opportunity to educate all the way down the line if they register.
If they register, then they know what the criteria is and what
it's something you can do online, and it's automatically, once it's accepted, the staff make sure that
no fees,
all the information can be given to them.
I agree. An it's a way to educate, to bring them in for them to know the rules. So I totally agree with that, but no $25 fee.
Madam Chair, I'd like to recognize Michael Aliota has sent a document, approximately 7 pages. I just want to make sure each of you have gotten it.
Yes, sir.
Get it? Okay. And I have concerns, just simply because it was just not too long ago where we had chickens running all over, and I'm going to say District 1, and it was a nightmare. We couldn't catch them. People were, running into them, trying to avoid them with their vehicles. Literally, I mean, we even went to try and caging them. Key West has a significant problem where at least once or twice a year they actually go out, they get the fire department, the police department, their code people, their employees, and they try and catch all these feral chickens. And my concern is, and I know that there's a conversation here about putting them in pens, but in the documentation that was provided to us, with recent pictures, the chickens are just running free in the neighborhood. And this is in the Sunland Gardens area, Harmony Heights area. I just have a concern that moving this into a realm in which we are not going to be able to control it, and then have a costly process by having to gather feral chickens after the fact. I'm just concerned.
Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
I get that, we've got 4-H kids that raise chickens, and there's a lot of good things there. However, having been with the city of Port St. Lucie when it voted against chickens, and knowing that we have homes that are in the county that abut to city homes. And I think that's a problem. I think that I can say, I can have a chickens, but my backyard neighbor cannot. So that's an issue for me, and I won't be supporting this.
Okay, I just want to address a couple of comments from Commissioner Zadowski. Commissioner Zadowski, we are not the keys, and that is a little bit crazier down there. I know, I was just there. They're like, they're in the restaurants. But for us here, the city already allows chickens, and that's unfortunately, that's your district. You are mainly the city of Fort Pierce. They already allow the chickens. So this ordinance isn't really going to have anything to do with the city ordinance if we pass it or don't pass it, because they're already allowed. Plus, there's peacocks running rampant through the city, and I know that they stop traffic in the whole nine yards. We have done this as a pilot study. It's been in effect for over a year now. There has been no concerns. It's happening. There's people there as well as down there where you're referencing, Commissioner Bartz. The 4-H families have this. That is basically more so, I think, for me, what I'm seeing is the homeschool families doing it. And I think
that the last year and a half that the pilot study's taken effect, there has been zero issues. I think it's proven for itself, and nothing's going to change except we're going to continue doing what we have currently been doing for the last year and a half. There's been no problems or concerns. I know I have been in conversation with some of the city officials that they're waiting to see what we do to decide where they go, because I know that there are several council members that are open-minded to this as well. And you know, Commissioner Zdowski, you do have an unusual circumstance. You have some ag people in your district as well as the city of Fort Pierce, so I know your challenges. But for me, we have proven that this program works. Has there been any issues at all?
No, Commissioner.
So, I mean, for me, we pilot studied this for a reason, to see if it would work, if there was any issues with it. There wasn't, so... I'm really not understanding why you wouldn't support it whenever it's already been in existence for a year and a half and there's been no issues and no concerns or anything, and the program's worked. So
it's just my history, and our animal control had incredible challenges to try to deal with the feral chickens. That's largely my concern. I mean, I could, and this is a public hearing, right? So I can probably wait to make any additional comments.
Yeah. So if we're done with the conversation, I will open it up to the public. Is there anybody out there wishing to come forward to speak? Please state your name for the record, please.
I'm Michael Aliota. Yesterday?
Okay, so state your name under the microphone.
Michael Aliota. I live at 3402 Avenue G in the county. I'm in Commissioner Zdowski's district. I think it's ironic we're standing here actually discussing this, because from my experience, at least in the 21st century, the county has allowed chickens and it has allowed roosters, because nothing has actually been done about the problem that was instigated by one family, one property, breeding chickens. And when complaints were made, they let the chickens loose. And now we have hundreds of chickens on the four-block area, at least at the southern end of what they call Sunland Gardens, but what I've come to understand from other residents is actually called Sable Palms. So I'm not sure what the name of the district or the subdivision is. But we've made numerous complaints over the years. Code enforcement has done nothing against people who have chickens in their backyard. Once the chickens were set loose, code enforcement said, they're nobody's chickens. This may ruffle a few feathers, but I've been made to understand from people at animal control and from one of the officers at code enforcement, that is what code enforcement told the people to do. Let the chickens run loose and no one can ticket you. And now we have hundreds of them for the last 17 years running around. I don't know how this is gonna work in other areas of the county. I don't know how it's working in the city. You say you have a pilot program. This depends on the responsibility and the attitudes of the people with the chickens. And in my neighborhood, the attitude is anything goes. The city instituted their change in their code a couple of years ago, and immediately people in my purview, people behind me, other people further down the block, started raising chickens in pens with roosters. So they did not, even though we're not in Fort Pierce, they did not comply to Fort Pierce law, and they never complied to the county law that they couldn't have chickens. In the present situation, if you were to approve this, people in Sunland Gardens will now have a ready excuse to continue the problem. Any rooster found in their yard, they will just claim it's a wild rooster that gets into their yard. They can do nothing about it. If they are threatened with tickets or any other kind of action, they will just let the chickens run loose. They will become part of the free-ranging population. No one will be able to identify them. If you are going to approve this, and honestly, perhaps if I wasn't living within this problem for 17 years, if I couldn't open my windows all day long, if I couldn't sleep past 3 a.m. without fans going, even in the winter, if I could still work from my house like I used to be able to do, I probably wouldn't have a problem with it. But under the circumstances with which we've been living with, if you allow this in Sunland Gardens, you are going to have an exponentially increasing problem. There's no way you can contain or do anything about the roosters now except to go around and actually shoot them. You can't trap them because they're not amenable to going into traps for food. You can't chase them down. They run 10 miles an hour. Animal control has come around on a few occasions. They've caught 15, 20 chickens and they threw in their hands up and said, we did what we could. The last time they came around, they actually left a rooster and two hens in my neighbor's property and wouldn't take them. For some reason, those chickens didn't breed. I don't know why. Either the neighbor decided that it was a good idea to get rid of the eggs when she found them, or the rooster was just improbably sterile or something. But that rooster was there for 3 years. In the meantime, the people right behind her started raising chickens with a rooster. And that rooster and that hen went and joined their population in the yard. The chickens generally get out of the yard and run around in the FPL right away behind us. They get into our yards. The free-ranging chickens are out in my yard every morning, scratching around at the grass. I have a tree there that's got really painful seed pods when you step on them. I try to keep my driveway clear of them. Every morning I get up 8, 9 o'clock in the morning, I go out there, and the whole driveway is covered with leaf litter from the tree. I have to sweep it out again. The real problem is for the people, for me and the other people who couldn't be here today, that if you allow this in Sunland Gardens, we're never going to get rid of this problem. It's just going to grow exponentially. If you're going to approve this, and I thought it was a fait accompli before I came here, but I see Chris and Commissioner Bartz seem to have issues with it. Exclude Sunland Gardens, just like you're excluding River Park. Make it so that people cannot legally have chickens in their backyard in Sunland Gardens, because there's no way you're going to be able to tell the difference between one chicken or another, and the people have already shown themselves to be irresponsible when it comes to breeding their chickens. You got my document, my 7 pages I wrote. I sent it by email, and I submitted it yesterday to the desk. I hope you'll take it seriously.
Commissioner Zadowski, isn't his area that he's referencing in the city of Fort Pierce?
No, not in the city.
It's in the county? Okay.
And we've never been agricultural.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Anybody else wishing to come forward? Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing and we'll come back to the board. Any more conversation?
Madam Chair, from the legal standpoint, we are excluding River Park, right? And that's largely because it's connected to and surrounded by the city of Port St. Lucie. Again, this has been a significant problem in this area. In good conscience, I couldn't support it just because of the challenges that we have. I mean, it's well documented. For years, we had to try and get to these chickens. And it really is a problem. So I don't know, from a legal standpoint, can we eliminate certain neighborhoods, or in the fact that, and see, maybe that's what we should have done in the beginning, is to have had the education in the community to get buy-in or not from the different homeowners associations, neighborhoods, and so on, to see if they would be supportive of it. Well, we have one individual here today, but I can assure you that the complaint calls that I had gotten years past and still today are about chickens just running free. The roosters are the bigger problem. I get that. So I don't know. Can we talk about that? I mean,
roosters are excluded. We know that. Right. You can have up to 5 chickens.
Right. I think we excluded River Park has been indicated because it's right in the middle of Port St. Lucie. Mm-hmm. That doesn't, is that really, and it has an overlay zone.
That's correct. We were able to justify the exclusion.
So I don't really know about the zoning of Sunland Gardens or whether it has any distinguishing factors. It's obviously in Fort Pierce or close to Fort Pierce, who apparently does allow chickens. So there's a little different facts there. But I don't know what the zoning categories are in there and whether there's some ability to craft a distinction that somebody couldn't come back in and say, well, wait a minute, why are you, you know, why are you excluding them? I'm in the same zoning district, and so we'd need to think about that. One option the board might want to think about, because you only have 4 members of the board,
right,
is to defer action on this for a couple weeks, perhaps, or longer, as you want. We've waited a long time. With the pilot program would stay in place. Give us a chance to go back and see if we can think about it, talk with the city, perhaps, of Fort Pierce, and come up with a strategy. We can also take the $25 fee out and when we represent it to you, so we'll have that out of there. It's just a suggestion.
And Madam Chair, don't get me wrong. I mean, we have supported 4-H from beginning to end, even in the worst of times, and we see the value in that aspect of this. It's those responsible ones that we should be doing this for, right?
Right.
It's the irresponsible ones in which we have a challenge. So I don't know if moving forward with a positive outcome today, with some option that in the enforcement, the code enforcement group is already understaffed, and the challenges are great. So it's going to be an enforcement issue that's going to be a challenge, and because this was just for 4-H families and those that are going to be responsible, that'd be one thing. But we know that there are those who are not going to be responsible, and there's going to be a cost associated with that. And the unfortunate part is if we end up with a situation where we have, you know, multiple chickens just starting to roam, it's going to be a challenge for, you know, health and safety.
Madam Chair, can I add on to that? You know, I kind of have to agree with Mr. McIntyre's idea of just pushing this out for a little bit, and I'm going to go on the reason why. When we're looking at River Park and we're looking at the possibility of eliminating or omitting other areas, I think it's going to be pertinent to this board, especially in light of the city of Fort Pierce. There are a lot, and I live in one of them, where I am in the city, but I'm surrounded by the unincorporated, or vice versa. So because of the way that they have annexed over the year, that's going to be something that we need to really look at least in my opinion. How does that gel with the city and what they're allowing and what we're possibly looking at? And Commissioner, I agree with you. The intent, I think, is great that we want to do it for the people that are responsible and so forth. That's why I asked about, could we at least do the educational of registering? But the other part of that is, I agree with Commissioner Sadowski. I've had animals in my backyard abutting it, not in my yard, but my neighbors, that were totally allowed to be done. They're in the county, but yet I'm in the city. So I appreciate you bringing that out. So even if we can look at a map of the unincorporated as it is, and as the areas are annexed within the city, we're going to see there's a lot of one house in many cases, areas that are caught in the middle of it. So
and I will tell you, I get the calls for the complaints, but I have not had one call asking for approval of chickens in my district specifically. But you know, I understand too, this is really a trend that's happening around the country, and I would like to support it, but my fears for the neighborhoods in which I represent are greater than my risk to support it today. But if we can push it off and get through some of the items that were recommended by legal, I'd be better. Right.
Madam Chair, the issue then, if the board's interested in pushing it off, do you want to do it in two, I guess it's 3 weeks, actually, October 6th, is that right, is the next board meeting, or do you want to do it on the 20th? Do I have my dates right on that?
That's correct.
So October 6th will be a night meeting, of course. October 20th would be your day meeting. So
okay, so I do agree that I think we've even identified really the bulk of the areas where these families are is Lakewood Park, Indian River Estates, the White City area, like around Sager, Kitterman, which is, they kind of feel they're in the country. And I've had a lot of calls from Indian River Drive, people in the drive that wanted, which shocked me.
There was one person that came.
No, I've actually had three people
really?
Talk to me. Yeah, that had requested it, which was shocking that they wanted it on the drive. But I think we can identify that too. So I would agree. And I'm in favor of taking it to the October 6th also for a night meeting, because that way it gives us more time to.
Okay, and then if we're not, hopefully we will be, but we can always continue it if we have to. But so then the appropriate motion would be to continue the public hearing to Tuesday, October 6th at 6 p.m. or soon thereafter.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
So, Madam Secretary, that's Commissioner Zadowski with Commissioner Hutchinson second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Leslie, I see you up there. Is there something you'd like to add?
I was just here to address zoning, Madam Chair. If you had any questions, we will address that on the night meeting at October 6th.
Thank you. Okay, so now we'll go to item B1.
Madam Chair, will this also include 8D1 and 8D2?
Well, I was going to ask, Mr. Tipton, do you want us to do this and then take the vote and then...
So there'll be the public hearing is 9B1,
right.
And then your next action staff would suggest you go ahead and take up 8D1 and 8D2.
That's what I was thinking. I just wanted to confirm.
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Commissioners. So this is a second public hearing of two for our CDBG Community Development Block Program application to the Florida Department of Economic Opportunity. St. Lucie County intends to apply to the Florida Department of Economic Opportunity for a small cities community development block grant program for housing rehabilitation in the amount of $750,000. A requirement of the CDBG application process is that the county hold at least two public hearings to announce the intent to apply for the grant and to allow for public comment and input on the application itself. This is the second of those two hearings. I would like to read for the following to ensure it becomes part of this hearing's record. If approved for funding, the county will rehabilitate or demolish and replace at least 11 very low, low, and moderate income family homes within the unincorporated area of St. Lucie County that do not meet current building code standards. The anticipated CDBG grant budget is as follows. Administration will be $112,500. This is to pay salaries for housing division staff to administer the program. Housing rehabilitation, $626,500, and temporary relocation in the amount of $11,000. That temporary relo goes to rehouse families while their project is being completed. In addition, the county intends to allocate $50,000 of the State Housing Initiative Partnership Program towards this project. The county will begin accepting applications for rehabilitation assistance from qualified homeowners if grant funding is awarded. A copy of the final application will be available for review at the St. Lucie County Community Services Office and online at www.slchousing.org no later than September 28, 2020. The application will be submitted to DEO on or before October 5, 2020. Public input regarding the CDBG application is encouraged.
Thank you. Any questions? This is a public hearing. Anybody wishing to come forward? Seeing none, we'll come back to the board.
Move approval.
Second.
So, Madam Secretary, this is Commissioner Zadowski with Commissioner Bart. Second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bart?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Okay, now we'll go back to Consent Agenda 8D1 and 8D2.
Move approval.
Second.
So, Madam Secretary, that was Commissioner Hutchinson making the motion. DZ with the second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. We'll move on to the regular agenda. County Attorney.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This item will be handled by Assistant County Attorney Catherine Barbieri, the board chair, and the board will recall that there is a gentleman in the audience.
Yes.
Who does wish to speak on this item?
Madam Chair, Board, for the record, Assistant County Attorney Catherine Barbieri, and what you have before you is request for permission to advertise a request for an order to demolish an unsafe structure located at 7407 Deer Park Avenue, Fort Pierce, Florida. The building located at 7407 Deer Park Avenue, Fort Pierce, Florida was inspected by the building official and has been determined to be unsafe and to constitute a public nuisance. The Code Enforcement Board, after hearing the facts in the case and the testimony of Robert Davidson, who claims to be the son of the deceased owner, ordered staff to bring the property to the Board of County Commissioners, as the Code Enforcement Board found the property to be a serious threat to the public health, safety, and welfare. Mr. Davidson resides at 7302 Pacific Avenue, which is around the corner, and he met with staff to discuss the building and the situation. He agreed to make some changes. On March 9th, the governor issued the executive order declaring that a state of emergency existed in Florida and that because of the spread of COVID-19 and the imminent threat to the welfare of citizens, and has extended the order. The building inspector has examined the property again on August 31st, 2020. From the outside, was not in the building or from the road, and they determined no action has been taken to correct the situation. The current property owner is Hazel B. Bright, who took ownership by warranty deed on March 18th, 1981. It is believed that she is deceased. There is no evidence that her estate has ever been probated. Staff recommends, under the provisions of Section 7-42, Appendix A, Local Acts, Article 7, Division 2 of the St. Lucie County Code of Ordinances and Compiled Laws, that the board accept the certified report of the inspection of building for filing, declare the building to be unsafe, authorize staff to order title work, and order that a public hearing be held so that the board may take further action as appropriate with regard to the unsafe building located at 7407 Deer Park Avenue, Fort Pierce, Florida.
Okay, Mr. Davidson, would you like to come forward, please?
When we look at the pictures, do we have a presentation of the pictures of the building?
We have them. I don't have them. I'm sorry. I don't know that I have them up. I apologize for that.
All right.
They're on the agenda.
Do we still have the camera on the ceiling? Down?
No? Because of the way that we're set up with it.
He's got them on a flash drive. If
sorry about that, guys. I thought that would have been loaded.
I apologize.
Sorry.
Okay, while they're doing that, we'll go ahead and let Mr. Davidson speak.
Very good.
I've been ordered by my physician to stay in, not overheat or overstress. Right now the weather's getting cooler, so it'll allow me to go over there and trim up the overgrowth. This is the way the property looked yesterday. I have decided the best thing to do is sell it. Here I have no less than 15 inquiries wanting to buy that property. Housing prices are going through the roof these days, and a lot of people want to buy them and flip them. The last proposal I had was a guy that wanted to buy it. He's a contractor, along with his two sons, rebuild it inside and out, and maybe even put a second story on it, make it a really first-class house. It's on a prime piece of property. It overlooks a lake, and it's professionally landscaped. And this landscaping is now mature. The well produces the best water I've ever seen in Lakewood Park, and the sewer system's good. I'm a little bit upset at this statement that it's a serious threat to public health and safety. I used to work with a group of consulting engineers, and we would inspect houses, structures. Mr. Harvey inspected it, looked into the attic, made the statement that the trusses looked reasonably different. The trusses he could see looked reasonably good. There was possibly need some replacement on part that he couldn't see. But this statement that it's a serious threat to public health and safety is just not true. I go over there all the time. I went over there last night, took a shower. I go over there, shower, use the toilet, do some cooking. Water over where I live is not very good. That water is. Well, I have decided to try to sell it. I'll evaluate all these proposals that I've gotten and sell the place as soon as I can. Of course, first I've got to get it probated. But it's not a serious threat to public health and safety, not in my opinion anyway. So I would ask the board not to condemn that house. If you condemn it, three things will happen. One, let me go back a little bit. That's a concrete block structure. It's not going to rot down. It's not going to termite down. And it would, number one, deny the county funds. I think I paid over $1,500 in taxes on that place last year. Number two, it would deny somebody the ability to own a home. The last proposal I got was from a contractor and his sons who want to rebuild it so that his younger son can have a house he can afford, stop renting. Number three, forgotten number three. But the weather's cooling off. I'll get over there and trim up the vegetation and try to get it probated and investigate getting it sold. I asked the commission not to condemn that house. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, can I ask you, why did it take this long? If that was your decision to sell it, why has it taken so long and that the neighbors have had to, share in this?
I had cancer. I had to undergo 45 gamma ray treatments. Kind of knocked the stew out of me. And secondly, a psychiatrist diagnosed me as having dysthymia. That's a biological imbalance, form of depression. Those of you who've never had that can't begin to understand what that does to you. But that's my excuses. And
thank you.
So,
any other questions? Okay, we'll come back to the board. Thank you. But I do have one question before you leave, Mr. Davison. Do you have the financial means to go ahead and hire an attorney to take this through probate?
No, but I want to ask for summary.
Okay, I need you to come back over to the microphone, please.
I'm going to ask for summary probate, and I think I can do it myself. I don't think I'm going to need an attorney.
Okay, thank you. So now I do have a question for legal. Just for clarification for the public and everybody too as well. If we do move forward with moving this is to determine basically because there was no will or anything, actually where the land goes to and there's no liens on it is what we're going to be identifying?
No, ma'am. We are not involved in the ownership of it. It's just on today we are requesting permission to advertise for condemnation. So you would give us permission to have a public hearing for the board to make a final determination on whether or not this building meets the standards by the code to tear it down. Ownership will never be involved in that. If you order the tearing down of it, a lien for the condemnation would be placed on the property. But ownership would still be determined by the courts.
Okay. I just needed that to be clarified. Mr. Davidson, I appreciate you wanting to engage, but I have to take it back to the board and the legal at this time. We need to discuss this because this is just to advertise. So I have to stop you at this point. I apologize, but we have to continue with legal now.
And I think that's a good point, is that you're going to have some time between the time we, if we move forward with the advertisement. The pressure is basically on you to move forward with whatever you're going to accomplish. So the time it's going to take to process the advertising and bring it back for a hearing.
You'll have months.
You'll have some time.
You'll have time to rectify this before it gets back to us and we actually move to this final process. So if that is your intent, this is going to give you a couple of months to be able to get that done.
There's no question of ownership. I'm the only child. She left a will, left it to me. That's all
okay.
I'm saying.
So if you have that, then that should be an easier process than to move it forward. Thank you. Okay, so.
Well, let's go ahead and look at the pictures, and that way at least we have an understanding of what we're discussing, because I don't think the folks at home are realizing what we're talking about.
Okay. Madam Chair, can I? Mm-hmm. I know you're sitting in, well, they had the pictures.
No, they're while they're getting ready. You can go ahead.
Okay, could you, could staff, I mean, Monica, could you give us an idea? Because, I mean, I've read the code enforcement board meeting minutes and so forth, but for the public, which may not have privy to that at this point without pulling, searching for it, could you give us an idea of how long this case has been ongoing? This wasn't something that was brought to us.
Several years. It's been several years.
Okay.
I believe yesterday, if I may add this information to this meeting this morning, that a citizen did reach out to Commissioner Townsend, and it's a neighbor, and she is interested, the husband and wife, in buying this property and, you know, having the home demolished. So if I could share that information with Mr. Davidson so that he, you know, because he said they won't reach out, he won't respond to them anymore. But they are interested in buying the property. But the community has had to endure this for quite some time.
Yeah, this has been going on since 2016.
Well, but again, so everybody has a clear understanding, right. This is not something that the county has taken lightly or come to, you know, move very quickly. We've been out there trying to work with and follow.
And the co-board, too.
Right.
The co-board's been working with
Not at all. Yes. We're actually trying to, we've reached out to see if there's any, you know, members in the community that can help him, church members. We kind of keep hitting a brick wall and all of that. The sheriff's department did visit with him just to make sure he was okay. Wanted to make sure he had a wellness check at his current home, which everything was fine with the sheriff's department. And so we're doing our best to help him. And there's still more time because this process is a lengthy process, at least another 90 days before you'll actually have that final hearing.
All right. Thank you.
Commissioner Zdowski?
I just... if you want to narrate the pictures, I think
I
think it's important to understand that we don't take these situations lightly, and that in this case it actually still has power to it. And the concern would be for any, you know, children are adventurous, and if there's an open door, an open window, and there's power to a property such as this, with the gaping holes and any rain and water, I'm afraid for public safety, and that electrocution might be an issue. So
actually the building official Doug Harvey is present this morning, and I could ask him to come up and talk to you about that.
I mean, we're going to have another hearing. I don't want to belabor it, because if this gets advertised or whatever the process is, I don't want to do the hearing today. I just wanted to raise my concerns that there is power to this house.
You are correct,
and so that's concerning from a safety standpoint.
You're correct. The building official, just for the record, felt that he did not see any imminent danger with regards to electricity, but that was what he could see. We can have that power turned off. It's not something that we typically do, but we can do that. There are quite a few pictures. But you can see there are multiple penetrations through the main roof structure. Over a dozen holes in the roof. The eaves are damaged and rotted. And the rafters are exposed.
Mold.
This is inside the home, the mold. The ceiling is actually collapsed in this area. That was the kitchen. Here's a picture of the living room. The ceiling has collapsed. Bedroom. This is a bathroom. Ceiling again is collapsed. And when I say collapsed, it is open to the elements, as you can see from the damage on the inside of the home. And the mold on the inside. Open to the elements.
Thank you.
Get it.
And again, this is just permission to advertise.
Right. So.
Correct. So is that your motion?
Yeah. Madam Chair, move approval to advertise.
Second.
Staff recommendation.
Okay, so Madam Secretary, that's Commissioner Zdowski, Commissioner Hutchinson second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zdowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Okay, thank you. We'll go to item two.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This item relates to the county's public utility system, the water, wastewater, and reclaimed water operations. Current county utility staff believes that it's in the best interest of the district and its ratepayers to issue a request for proposals for utility operation services to ensure that the district's getting the best possible service at a fair and competitive rate. In conjunction with the issuance of the RFP, district staff also recommends that the district provide a notice of termination to the existing agreement with Infomark without cause with 180 days prior notice as required by the agreement. We also intend at a district level, and the board approved it on their consent agenda, to investigate whether operating the district system with district personnel in lieu of a contract operator would be feasible and cost competitive. In other words, we're proposing to look at all options and see if we can find the best possible option for the district and its ratepayers. Madam Chair, with that in mind, staff recommends that the board authorize advertising the RFP and authorize staff to issue the notice of termination without cause to Infomark, terminating the 2007 agreement. So again, we haven't really competitively done this for some period of time. We think it's time to do that.
Okay, thank you. Questions? Comments? Motion?
Madam Chair, move approval.
Second.
Okay, so Madam Secretary, that was Commissioner Hutchinson, Commissioner Bartz second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Zdowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Item three.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This item relates to ratification of the Public Safety Director's declarations of emergency, the extensions, which are every 7 days for the COVID-19 public health emergency. We've done this before. We take these back to the board for ratification. This time we're suggesting you ratify the July 28th, August 4th, August 11th, August 18th, and August 25th extension. Staff recommends approval.
Madam Chair, move approval.
There a second?
Second.
The Madam Secretary, was Commissioner Hutchinson, Commissioner Zdowski with the second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zdowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Item four.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This item relates to also declarations of emergency, but in this case, for Hurricane Isaias. In August of this year, the Public Safety Director declared a state of emergency for that hurricane. There were extensions issued on August 8th, August 15th, August 22nd, and August 29th. Staff recommends that the board approve the resolution ratifying those declaration and the extensions.
Thank you. Any comments? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
So Madam Secretary, this Commissioner Zdowski, Commissioner Bartz second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zdowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Item five.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This item relates to after-the-fact permission to apply for a grant for the North Hutchinson Island Septic to Sewer Project. Mr. Landry or Mr. Santos is in the audience if the board has any questions, but they did identify a potential grant opportunity. The board's already received a $990,000 grant for this project from the Department of Environmental Protection, but there is a further opportunity of potentially $565,000 to further help support that project. The deadline for the grant was August 21st. We didn't have the opportunity to present the board before that, so we submitted the application on time. It was signed by the interim utility director, I guess now permanent utility director. Staff's requesting after the fact approval for submitting the grant to the board.
Thank you. It's all good news. Is there a motion?
Move approval.
Second.
So, Madam Secretary, that's Commissioner Zdowski with Bartz second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zdowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Item six.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is another emergency order that was issued during the COVID pandemic. This particular order relates to authorizing temporary zoning compliance for 7791 South US 1. This property is zoned planned non-residential development. So the essence of that is that it involves one of the advantages of having that zoning district is you can restrict uses. You can really just designate the types of things that can actually be done there. In this case, it does not allow a hairstylist. So we, through planning and development, they recommended that we issue an order that would allow a temporary use for this hair salon. She's in the process of working to obtain her business tax receipt, and I guess there's also an effort to amend the planned non-residential development to allow a broader range of uses that would include this particular use. Madam Chair, if the board has any questions, I believe the planning department is in the audience and can answer those questions if the board has any. Staff recommends approval.
Okay, thank you. Is there any questions? If not, motion. Would somebody like to make the motion?
I want to ask a question. This says temporary, and then I also heard Mr. McIntyre say that this is going under review from the planning department for additional changes in the PNRD. I just want to understand that better.
Madam Chair, Commissioner Zadowski, good morning. Leslie
good
Olson,
morning.
Planning and Development Services Director for the record. Both of those things are correct, yes. This authorization is temporary in nature in a similar way to a suspension of zoning that we enacted for a particular church use after Hurricane Irma. Their school was damaged in Hurricane Irma, and they had to move in an emergency. And there was an order signed by the county administrator at that time to suspend zoning so that they could locate in a certain location as they pursued their conditional use that would be required. In a similar way, this particular business owner was not able to utilize her existing chair at Club Med when it closed, and another business owner, out of the kindness of his heart, offered her a space in his chiropractic office. Because of the PNRD, that could not be done because it was limited in use. But when planning evaluated the use and the PNRD, we found that it would not create undue hardship for this area to add this use, but it does need to go back through the process. They are now pursuing that, but as a result of the COVID pandemic, we felt it was appropriate to suspend that particular zoning for a short period of time in a similar way.
Okay, I like that explanation. And of course, we have made a lot of adjustments due to this pandemic. And so that being said, I'd move approval of temporary as staff has recommended.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Savoy, do you have something to add?
No, ma'am.
Okay. All right, so, Madam Secretary, that was Commissioner Zadowski with Commissioner Hutchinson second. Would you call the roll, please?
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchinson?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Item 7.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Actually, we can perhaps talk about 7, 8, and 9 together because they are related. We are proposing a temporary reduction of development application fees, building permit fees, and I would call this environmental regulation fees of 15% for a period of 365 days to respond to the economic impact of the COVID-19 public health emergency. Those are identified in separate resolutions. But Madam Chair, Mr. Satterley has been chairing a work group involving, I believe, the Economic Development Council and the Chamber, and perhaps he has additional comments.
Thank you, Mr. McIntyre, Madam Chair, members of the board. That's correct. We have been working actually with the Chamber's Development Review Task Force since 2012, 2011 even. In the recession, the Great Recession, we worked with them and developed the waivers, deferrals, and alternatives program. And then subsequent to that, in more recent years, we've been working with the Development Review Task Force of the Chamber to look at ways that we can continue to improve service. We've been working with them specifically on our engineering division. But recently, we received a letter from the task force asking us to address COVID, if there were steps that the county would consider taking that would be a help to our local businesses to either continue to stay open or expand in the pandemic. And so, as Mr. McIntyre has said, items 7, 8, and 9, and also in B1, which is an amendment to the Land Development Code, next item, these are all items that have come out of that task force, those recommendations. We have evaluated them, and we feel that these are appropriate as temporary measures. Thank you.
And this is all good stuff. It's a good program. Any comments, questions? If not, somebody like to make a motion? Now, we're going to have to do these each individual open motions, or we do
I
all?
I think you could combine. They're not okay. Public hearings. There okay. are separate resolutions, so you'd have to move approval of
7, 8, and 9.
7, 8 were resolution 2210, 2211, and 2212.
Okay, so I'll entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, move approval resolution 20-210. Move approval resolution number 20211 and move approval resolution number 20212.
Second. Okay, so Madam Secretary, 7, 8, 9 is the motion made by Commissioner Zadowski, second by Commissioner Bartz. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
And Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you. We'll move to item B1.
Madam Chair, this is the amendments to the Land Development Code. This is a companion of the three items that you just acted on. This is to make some additional amendments to the Land Development Code. This is a permission to advertise. Leslie, do you want to provide a little more detail?
Madam Chair, again, Leslie Olson for the record. We are proposing some permanent changes to the Land Development Code to spur redevelopment and development in light of the economic impacts from the COVID pandemic. They are varied. If you'd like us to go through them specifically, I'm happy to do so. We will be talking with you more fully about these proposals as they move through the process, but we will be bringing them to the Planning and Zoning Commission and then to you again.
Anybody have any questions?
Yeah, move approval, permission to advertise.
Second.
So, Madam Secretary, it was Commissioner Zadowski. Commissioner Bartz, second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Item 2. I do want to recognize that we have Mr. Tesh here from EDC, and I know that he was also, isn't Pete here somewhere? I thought I saw him. He's not, because I know he's
Teresa.
Also, what?
Teresa was here.
Teresa was here earlier too. So, I mean, that's all a really good program and it's good stuff. So I'm grateful for that. Good morning.
Good morning, Madam Chair and Commissioners. For the record, Bethany Grubbs with the Planning and Development Services Department. This petition for a major site plan on behalf of John Byers and Southern Trust Companies. Southern Trust is a targeted industry manufacturing and supplying trusses locally and throughout South and Central Florida. This project required a two-part rezoning, a lot split, and site plan review to facilitate their proposed capital investment. The final rezoning for the project stormwater tract was before the board on August 4th last month, with the revised site plan expeditiously reviewed by the Development Review Committee for consideration by the board today, September 15th. The undeveloped parcels of land consist of 22.67 acres overall and are located at 6509 St. Lucie Boulevard in Fort Pierce. This is an aerial perspective of the property, and the area outlined in red indicates the subject site. The property is located at the southwest corner of St. Lucie Boulevard and Taylor Dairy Road, and the site was a former citrus grove. The properties are zoned industrial light and are located within the town, village, and countryside future land use and overlay zone. Currently, Southern Trust operates at a site just to the west located along Kings Highway. This major site plan will provide continued capacity to grow their targeted industry operations. This facility relocation expansion is to support the future development of a new trust plant based upon business needs. The project consists of 150,000 square foot manufacturing facility and supporting ancillary uses, inclusive of a 10,000 square foot administrative building, a 6,000 square foot truck maintenance area and office space, lay down and storage yards with associated parking, landscaping, and stormwater improvements. Water and wastewater services are available to the site from St. Lucie Boulevard and will be provided by Fort Pierce Utilities Authority, who has signed off on this proposal. A 12-inch force main is located along the east side of Taylor Dairy Road, and a 12-inch water line is located along the north side of St. Lucie Boulevard. Lastly, upon analysis by the county's traffic engineer, the adjacent impacted roadway has sufficient capacity available to support the proposed project's trips. Staff has determined that the proposed major site plan meets the standards of review outlined in Section 110207 of the Land Development Code and is consistent with the goals, objectives, and policies of the comprehensive plan. Therefore, staff recommends the board adopt the resolution subject to the proposed conditions outlined within and which is provided in your agenda package. That concludes my presentation. Staff and the applicant's representative are available to answer any questions that you may have. And thank you.
Thanks. Any questions?
Just one. Do we have the right of way for the roadway? I know that that was
the dedication of right of way is a condition of approval.
All right. I just want to make sure because we know that FDOT's looking at that road for the future expansion. So. Just want to make sure.
Mm-hmm. Madam Chair, because this is a quasi-judicial, I'll go ahead and declare mine. I've not talked with anyone other than staff.
As I. Anybody else have any disclosures?
I spoke with staff, and I'm pretty sure I've spoken to Dennis on this one.
Only spoken to staff.
Okay. Is there any questions or anything? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
Okay, so Commissioner Zadowski made the motion. Commissioner Bart second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bart?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zadowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll go to item C. Good morning.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, for the record, Jim Offenborn, Public Works. I'm here to talk about our latest artificial reef deployment, Paul Jacklin Reef and reef naming. Reef was deployed the first week of August this year. Luckily, we had materials, two different types of materials. One, we had about 400 concrete column footers from the demolition of the port warehouse. We also had some bridge slab. By themselves, these materials would not make that a very, very good reef, but we managed to combine them. The reef location, if you remember last year, we deployed the Wasse Bernadette or the CCA Chris Bosick Reef. This reef was designed to actually help recruit juvenile fishes from the sands and as larvae into juveniles, and then as some adults they could then recruit to the Chris Bosick Reef. we had to design the reef because we had such a high profile reef with the Curtis Bostic reef. We wanted to design something a little bit lower profile that would be amenable towards juvenile fishes, but we didn't want the slabs to lay flat on the bottom. So what we did is we deployed the concrete column footers first and then followed by the slabs. And we separated this in 12 different units. We had each reef was only 160 tons rather than the 500 tons usually put, or multiples of 500 tons. All right, the design of the reef, if you look over on the right here, we have the Vossig Bernadette, the CCA Curtis Bostic Reef, and then we have 12 smaller reefs, three columns by four rows. The first day, we would deploy 160 tons. First pair right here, move the move the barge over to the second reef, deploy there, then move the barge over third time, deploy there. Gives us on four separate days. It gives us 12 different reefs. The deployment sequence was pretty important in this because we wanted to make sure that the concrete column footers went in first, followed by the bridge slab. We did this because we wanted to provide low profile ledges for smaller juvenile fish and invertebrates. The results were pretty good. I was hoping for at least one ledge per reef. This is the photographs of our volunteers who went out and dived the area. This is all only one of the reefs. You see here we have a very low profile ledge here. We have another very low profile ledge here. And there is space between the ledge and the bottom. Here's a little bit higher profile ledge here with this slab laying on top of the concrete complex. Here is another area where you have an even higher profile ledge. What you'll notice on all of these reefs is a preponderance of bait fish, something very, very good. The National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration is actually trying to promote conservation of bait fish. We have a fairly large snook here. If you consider that this slab is about 6 feet wide, that's probably about a 6-foot snook. Now, finally, I have a short little video, if we have time, that, again, our volunteers took. This video shows the ledges, shows the concrete column footers. Even with just the footers, you have a lot of what they call cryptic habitat, nooks and crannies for smaller fish to get in. These smaller fish are, again, they're forage fish. They're energy for your larger fish. They're tomtates, grunt family. So we were very, very happy to see this. It was only 7 days post-deployment. Notice there's no growth on them yet. These will be very, very good reefs to help out the CCA Curtis Bostic reef. Questions?
Does anybody have any questions?
I have a question, just a comment. This is turning into an amazing, amazing reef, Jim. You're doing great work, and the quality of the material that you're getting and the volunteers that you have are exceptional. And I did follow a lot of the pictures and the videos that were provided that you sent out in the past, and it's amazing. The fishing is just going crazy out there, so good job. I mean, this is amazing, so great job.
Thank you very much.
I agree, and the divers and the fishermen are loving it too. So it's all good stuff. So is that a motion, Commissioner Zawoski?
Move approval with excitement.
Is there a second?
Second.
So, Madam Secretary, that's Commissioner Zawoski with Commissioner Bart second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Bart?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zawoski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Townsend?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. That brings us to the conclusion of our meeting. Is there any announcements from the board? Mr. Tipton, would you like to close us out?
Madam Chair and Commissioners, our next budget hearing and final budget hearing will be September 24th at 6 p.m. here in these chambers. Our next regular board meeting will be October 6th at 6 p.m. here in these chambers. And just as a reminder, that the Atlantic hurricane season is full speed and it is near record activity. And so as just a reminder, hurricane season is not a spectator sport. It requires everybody to have a plan, and so we just encourage everybody to continue to monitor and watch, but make sure that you are prepared. Thank you.
Thank you. Everybody enjoy your day.
We'll come to order. St. Lucie County Erosion District. First on the agenda is general public comment. Is there anyone from the public? Seeing no one, will move to today's consent agenda. Is there a motion?
If there's no discussion.
Second.
It's a motion by Commissioner Townsend. Second by Commissioner Zdanowski. Madam Chair, Madam Secretary, would you please call the roll?
Commissioner Bartz?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zdanowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Townsend?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am. The motion passes. There is no regular agenda. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
We are adjourned.
Mosquito control.
We're adjourned.
Mosquito control. Next.
Who has mosquito control?
Is that Sean?
Sean has mosquito control and he's not present. So,
Lynn right, Bars, the vice chair is Commissioner Bars.
So I need to do mosquito control.
You have it close by?
You want me to do it?
Thank you. Okay, I'd like to call the meeting to order for mosquito control.
Microphone.
Your microphone closer.
Hold.
I try this again?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I'd like to call the meeting to order for mosquito control. And our first business is general public comment. Anybody wishing to address? Seeing no one, I will close that. On approval of minutes from the August 18th meeting.
Move approval.
Second.
Thank you. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Zdanowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Townsend?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Bartz?
Yes, ma'am. Motion for the consent agenda.
Madam Chair, move approval.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Yes, call the roll.
Gotta call the roll.
Commissioner Hutchison?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Townsend?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Zdanowski?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair Bartz?
Yes. No items on the regular agenda. I have a motion to adjourn.
So moved.